Good morning. Good morning. I'm Chris Barker. I am the Vice Dean for the College of Arts and Science, and it's my privilege to welcome you to this symposium. One thing I have to tell you right off the bat is you are being filmed. The entire symposium will be filmed. That's very much in keeping with the spirit of the symposium, but you have to be aware of that. 2 years ago, the provost challenged the university to figure out ways of innovating tech-enhanced education. CIS rose to that challenge. Dean Gabby Starr proposed asking for some of the money the provost had offered. And no operation of this size and magnitude can happen without many, many people contributing. But in addition to Dean Starr, I want to mention Armanda, of course, who is the heart and soul behind all of these operations. There were 2 3-day workshops that were conducted in order to try and foster innovation. One in January of 2016, the other in May of 2016. And there was participation from both the Expository Writing Program and the Foreign Languages Group. 54 people participated in the workshops. That's a huge number. And this resulted in lots and lots of innovation. 94 sections of classes were impacted by this tech-enhanced education. That's huge. That's amazing. And we're here today to hear about the results of these creative acts. It's very exciting. I'm looking forward to it very much. It's momentum building in favor of tech-enhanced education. That is crucial. If we are a global network university, then we are a network university. We have to get on board with tech-enhanced education, and we're doing that in very creative ways. I want to also emphasize that many of the solutions involve mobile applications. That's good, too. And in fact, the provost may have said, let's get tech-enhanced education, but he at the time may also have said, let's have some fun. That's what I expect to have today, and I'm very much looking forward to learning about tech-enhanced education. Welcome.
Hi everyone, my name is Caitlin LeMay. I work with Armanda in the Office of Educational Technology. We have a packed schedule today, so let's get right into it. Our first panel is on active and student-centered learning. So I would like to invite Elizabeth Augsburg up to show off her mobile game for Spanish language learning.
Okay. Good morning, everyone, and thank you. This started because the Spanish department has really been pushing for more technology, things that address what students have been doing lately outside the classroom. And our director, Javier Elorrieta, keeps sending us links of things to attend online, workshops. And I did attend one that was about gaming. And I found it interesting, but not specific enough. One thing that really worries me about the trend of language is that although it's a good thing that we emphasize speaking and having fun in class, I worry about precision. I think that a college-educated student should understand what an adjective clause is, should understand what parts of the sentences are, that it's not about just speaking by intuition. And so I thought, how can I make this fun? Because of course you say the word grammar and everybody starts yawning. And so these ideas were floating in my head when Armanda came up with this workshop, and that was a great incentive to write a proposal for it. And I based it on Trivia Crack, which is an app that my 15-year-old daughter kept using over and over again for a while. Really helps to have a teenager at home. So, and the best way to experience it is actually, I can show it to you here, but it's now, you can get it for free at the iTunes Store or Google Play. It works both ways, and that's the best. If you go and look for it under, Cómete el coco. It's C-O-M-E-T-E. C-O... I can type. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Yes, that's right. It's up there. Cómete el coco. And you don't need the accent. So if you go in there, You can download it. It won't take long to download. And I'll walk you through it and explain to you how it works. The biggest problem with this, as you download it, I'll tell you, is the amount of questions you have to write for it. One good thing is that everyone, any language can use this software. I mean, NYU has already set it up. The IT team is great. So if you change the categories and put in your questions, it should work fine. How's everybody doing with it? You got it? No? It's Comete el Coco, and you have to enter as guest. Now, the students, our students, the way it's set up is because I had originally intended this to be for Intermediate Spanish 3, which is the course that I teach, right? And that's it. I hear the music. So we have three levels, right, of questions. The first level covers the first two chapters of the book we are working with, which is currently Imagina. So the vocabulary section will reflect the first two chapters of that book. The vocabulary section, so as you spin, you land on a category, right? And you have to answer the question. It's like a trivia game. After you answer it, whether you answer it correctly or incorrectly, you will get a very, very brief explanation, a prompt, basically. This is really, the game is not intended as a study guide. Oh. Thank you. Oh, here we spin. So you landed on preterite versus imperfect, right? And there's your question. There's a lag between the question and before the answers appear, because we don't want the students guessing. We want informed choices. So you get that, you see? You get your answer, the correct answer, and a very brief explanation, all right? So as the students play this, you can either play it solo, which is the option you have right now. You don't have the option to compete against someone else. But the way IT set it up for me, the way I asked for it, is so that students can play against each other. The object is to get all the icons. In the first section would be translation, preterite imperfect, vocabulary. What else do we have there? Perífrasis. There are a bunch of icons. So you play. You get to play until you lose, and then your streak is over. And you challenge before. If you're in the class, you challenge another student. So you play, you lose. It's the other student's turn. So he plays or she plays until she loses, and whoever gets the most icons first wins. Yay, you win. And also, as you answer correctly, you rank up. And this is really important because you start off as nothing, and you move on to aprendiz, which is apprentice, then you move on to master, companion, then master, then venerable master. And as you move, this is something we still have to work a bit because it's not working as well as I'd like it to. I want it to be based on correct answers rather than on wins, because we have had, it still needs tweaking. It's not perfect, you know. It's very good, but it's not perfect. So as you advance, say you move up to aprendiz, apprentice, I get an email message saying so-and-so has moved up to apprentice, and it shows me where the student has, so it says, say, preterite imperfect, 75% correct, vocabulary, 80%. So I can see where they're having trouble. You know, we were a little worried about the student feedback because we weren't sure, you know, FERPA, etc. But in the end, we worked around it, and it really is good for us to see how students, and also right now I can see how many students are playing it and how it's going. In order to maintain student enthusiasm, we unlock level 1 week before the first exam. So students have 1 week to play. So if I challenge Aline over here, Aline, I, I play against her, and she has one day to respond, 24 hours. If she doesn't respond in that time, I win by default. Now, I don't need just to challenge Aline. I can challenge everyone in here. I can play with everyone at the, you know, because people take some time to respond. Or I can play on my own. Either way is fine. So that's level one, a week before the exam. We don't close it after that. You can continue to play, but students obviously, of course, they are excited to play before the exam. They won't play so much after it. And then a week before the second exam, the second level unlocks, okay? The biggest challenge it was very easy to work with the team at NYU. Armanda had great enthusiasm for the game. I couldn't believe when she thought this was a worthwhile cause. I just wrote it in and I said, oh, whatever. And she loved it and she really pushed it. And also the NYU team is great at putting things together, sending you stuff to look at and agree or not agree. They're very quick responders to everything. So that was a great experience. And as I say, we're still working on it. For instance, one of the problems the students have told me is that, oh, I challenge someone and then I don't get an answer. And so the other person doesn't know. So we have to work on those quick notifications you get on the phone. So that's one thing. Right now we're solving it for the short term with an email message, but everybody knows students don't read those anymore. But for now, that's what we're doing. How am I doing with time? I should wrap it up. Okay, so that's it, and thank you.
Thank you so much, Elizabeth. And I also want to mention we will have time for a Q&A at the end of the panel. So if you do have questions, make sure to write them down, and we can take those at the end of the panel. But for now, I would like to invite up Javier and Sophie from Spanish and Portuguese to present active learning in ebook and video postings.
Good morning, everyone. So basically, we're going to talk about two of the projects that we have created in the Spanish department for Spanish for Beginners 2, the second semester. We have developed a few projects, but we're only going to talk about two of them. All the sections for Spanish 2, about 13 sections, worked on an ebook, creating an ebook, based on a narration that they did in the past, right? However, the situations and video postings for Spanish 2 also was done only in Javier's section, which is for students from teach students. Well, so, okay. So for the ebook, for example, they were given three choices. They were either going to create a modern adaptation of a traditional children's story, an adaptation of an urban legend, or an original children's story or an original urban legend authored by students. So they could do an adaptation or write one just some of the students that have very creative minds and actually write for fun, they opted, you know, for this one to create their own story. So basically our objective was to practice preterite versus imperfect, which is one of the most challenging topics for English speakers. So, and the strategies, of course, it was to use collaboration in writing as a means for students to learn from their peers, to create an ebook for publishing to increase student engagement, and to share and comment peers' work in a common digital platform in order to create accountability and to provide real life experience. So the narration in the past was done in three different drafts. So students submitted the first draft that they wrote in class without notes or anything like that. Instructors corrected that draft with a set of symbols, right? Then students turned it in again. We corrected it with the symbols again. And then the third one was the final one that they actually created the ebook with. So let me show you a few examples. I want to go into the side. For that, we created, or Amanda helped us a lot to create the WordPress page or site. Okay, so we created that WordPress site, and they were supposed to upload the ebook there. So in their ebook, they had to find images. Some of them decided to write their own images, and others, to draw their own images. Others decided to get images from the internet. However, they were asked to keep track of the places where they got these images, put it as a reference sheet at the end. The last part of the project was for every student individually, because the ebooks were created in pairs, for each individual to write a review of another project. So I gave my students the option of either posting a comment right there in the site, in the WordPress site, or to turn in a paragraph written like traditionally, right? So most of my students decided to go into the page and write the comment in the right there in the platform. So I was like, okay, well, I thought they were gonna be like a little embarrassed, you know, to show the writing to other students, but no, really, most of them chose that. So for example, ebook, right? We have in this page like all their different sections for ebooks. I'm gonna show you. This is how the page looks like, right? They created, for example, La Caperucita Roja, and it's a Caperucita Roja, like Little Red Riding Hood, like the modern version of it. A little girl that finds a biker in the street, and the biker says, "I wanna steal your food," because she was going to her grandma's house, etc. So other students, you know, did their own illustrations like that. Catman and Robin, Cruzadores de Casa. I like this one because this is like a promotion for NYU. It's like how to choose to get to, how to choose a university. So they basically did El Mago, how do you call it?
The Wizard.
The Wizard of Oz. In Spanish, to say how they got to choose NYU, you know, as the best place to study. So that was a neat one. Also, there was another group that decided to write their own urban legend, and they did a fantastic, beautiful job also there. They were also supposed to record themselves reading the story, as you would see in a traditional, not traditional, but a modern ebook for children that you go page by page and then you hear someone reading the story. So yeah, La Lápida Embrujada. We're not gonna play the whole thing, but just for you to get an idea of how this looks. So it starts like that. And they worked in pairs, and then, you know, you hear their voices narrating the story in Spanish and using preterite versus imperfect. I saw that the way they used the tenses was excellent. They have many problems in other stuff, but the preterite and imperfect, you know, were done very, very good. So it actually were perfect. So they created this story, and at the end, they even prepared a trailer for the movie, right? So that was fantastic. But then maybe Javier wants to talk about also the video postings that they did for the teach section, right? It's like a similar concept that they had to post and then comment on other people's other groups work. So, debería estar en la parte de arriba.
What is the original presentation?
PowerPoint. Okay. And this is the interesting part. Whenever we ran into trouble, Armanda was always like there, you know, answering right away the questions. and even coming to the office to help us tweak these things.
Okay.
Okay, so I don't know how much time we have, but it's a similar concept, but the fact that this was the oral role plays that we have in many classes as a way of testing their oral proficiency and how much they have progressed in their oral abilities. And the idea was that instead of making it with like a traditional setting where they come to in front of the professor or the instructor and they perform this role play, they would have them do a little more preparation for it so that the product will be maybe not as spontaneous, but maybe better, because we didn't want them to post something that was just full of grammar errors, maybe. And so they wrote a script that I looked at briefly. I pointed out stuff. I didn't correct it. I pointed out the stuff that they needed to look into. So it still came with some mistakes, but at least it was a more like an improved product. And they came the ideas were the usual ideas for this, that they established this conflict and a solution. They have to negotiate this meaning in Spanish, and they have to present it now in front of the class in the form of a video. So it takes them some time to do the video, and some of them do some very regular videos where they just, there's a camera and it's filming them and they're not moving. But some of them, come up with some very inventive stuff where they come up with an actual story, an actual situation, and this was the case of an interview for a roommate, and so then they had very different habits, and that was the conflict that they had to come up with, and then decide on their own if they would be good roommates or bad roommates. So the idea is the same as always, has to practice the grammar and vocabulary, and to show that the control they have of that. But the idea would be that it would be in a more collaborative environment. They would be showing each other. They could comment on each other's postings. They could make use of other possibilities like body language, other stuff outside in the real world that are also abilities that we want language learners to have, and have a better scripted maybe dialogue than the usual. So going back, and also then having this possibility of to comment on each other's on each other's projects. So briefly, Armanda really helped us with this, and it was really, with our help, we couldn't have done it. These are the main areas, and the situations are here, and the ebook were there, which make that section also did an ebook. And the situations are, you see them there. They're videos of the students, coming up with, talking to each other. And the more fun ones, I guess, were the ones where there was this conflict. Just so briefly, one was more of a partier, and the other one was more of studying Russian literature as a PhD student. So they were not getting along with each other, and there was this conflict between the two of them. So it's not loading, unfortunately. maybe this one. Well, I wish we could show you. Yeah. But anyway, the results were good. They were not, I wouldn't say that they were like excellent or that they learned maybe more than they would have, but it increased the interaction, and I think that is also something that they could be proud of and that they could comment on. Mm-hmm. How do you feel?
I think also the motivation, the fact that they know that they're going to do something creative and to show it to other people really makes them work for it. So I think that is like just one of the many, many benefits of doing these platforms online and sharing with everyone and reviewing their work. So I think this is it, now that we cannot show that video, but anyway. So
we wish we could show you.
Yeah. Okay, so. Yeah.
So we have a scheduling conflict, so we're going to, we're actually good? Great, okay. Never mind, we will move on as planned. Melanie Hackney and John Moran from the French department will present on Classrooms Without Borders, a service and study OA's integrated course components. And let's pull up more slides. Oh, you sent them in Google, correct?
Okay. Great. Thanks so much, everyone. And I will get right to it since we have limited time. So first of all, we wanted to just show one of the innovative ways that we've been advertising this course this year. This is the first time we tried this because promoting our course is really, really important just because we have students have to apply and then there's a process for getting into the course. So we're going to show you how we're doing that. The idea for this class grew out of two separate programs with which I was involved as a graduate student. I co-taught an undergraduate course that incorporated a study abroad component into a regularly scheduled semester-long course, and I participated in an immersion course in Arnoville, Louisiana. And combining these two models, John and I decided to incorporate a community service component, which seemed like a natural fit for a trip to Louisiana, where ever since Hurricane Katrina in 2005, community service has become an integral part of the academic and broader communities. From there, we designed a two-credit course that would create an experiential learning community by first introducing students to the historical, linguistic, social, and cultural contexts of French in Louisiana, and then immersing these students into those contexts through a spring break study away trip to New Orleans, Baton Rouge, and Arnoville, Louisiana, which is in the heart of Cajun country. We approached the Office of Student Activities, Leadership, and Service about the possibility of incorporating an alternative break program into the course, and we found that the goals for both of the programs aligned perfectly. So we worked with alternative breaks to include a traditional community service component as well as a broader academic service component into the class. And the outcomes, which John will speak about in just a few minutes, far surpassed our expectations. So part language, part literature, and pure immersion course, we devised a syllabus, an itinerary, set a language proficiency level as a prerequisite, advertised the course, and received an overwhelming number of applicants to the program. Our principal goals, this real quick is our itinerary. It's in French. It's just to show you how jam-packed it is. As we started 7-8 in the morning and finished 8 or 9 at night, and students were doing activities all day long, total immersion, everything done in French. So it's great. So I'll talk a little bit about our goals for the program. Our principal goals were improved oral proficiency, and so that students would benefit from an immersion program without the cost or time commitment involved in studying away at NYU Paris. However, we also hope that this would serve as an incentive for students who may want to study abroad, but who have reservations or lack the linguistic confidence. Experiential learning, to encourage students to see what they do in the classroom is beneficial outside the classroom walls, that what they learn is applicable in real-life contexts. A broader understanding of the French language and the populations that speak it, in particular as it pertains to Francophone Louisiana, and to open students' eyes to the diversity of the French language and the populations who speak French, and to break down stereotypes about what constitutes correct French. And finally, to become a more informed and engaged global citizen. Students' participation in the course and their interactions with Louisiana French speakers in particular would allow them to give back to the French-speaking community and to contribute to the preservation and awareness surrounding French in Louisiana. To achieve these goals, the course consisted of 7 class sessions preceding the spring break trip, 2 fundraisers, an icebreaker dinner at John's house. And we began with an introductory session that helped to gauge some of the attitudes toward preconceived notions about and stereotypes around Louisiana. And the following 2 sessions focused on the historical context of French in Louisiana, followed by two sessions introducing students to Louisiana, or Cajun French, as it's called, which included a visiting faculty fellow and specialist on Louisiana French from Louisiana State University. And we ended with two sessions on Louisiana French literature. The spring break trip took place over 10 days and included a day of service, several museum visits and tours, excellent and copious amounts of food, a plantation tour, bayou tours, Cajun cooking classes, a poetry night, a card night social, and much more. All of this was done in French, of course. And finally, the students conducted and recorded interviews with Louisiana French speakers, which we are compiling on an oral history website for which each student in the course becomes a contributing author. And now John will talk a bit about the outcomes.
Yeah. So I'll go through the outcomes relatively quickly because fortunately they kind of match up with the goals so that we have time to make sure we have time to show you the oral histories website, which is kind of one of the more exciting things that came out of this class. So with regard to oral proficiency, we were quite frankly stunned at how much improvement we saw, especially among our lower level students. The students, the lowest level students could come in with was fifth semester French. And of course there was the work in the class, but it was really having that immersion experience and then afterwards working with that, posting, doing analyses and posting things on the Oral Histories website, that really there was a marked, dramatic improvement among the lower level students that really stood out, so that was nice. And then in connection to connections between what we had studied in New York and then what they actually saw on the ground, it was a great way to reinforce this with the students and kind of give them a sense of purpose for what they could do with French. So just one small concrete example, Melanie mentioned that we had a guided tour of Laura, which is one of the few fully restored Creole plantations. In New York, we had read, during our 2 days of literature, we had read a novel called Habitation Saint-Hubert, which takes place in a Creole plantation in pre- and post-Civil War Louisiana, and afterwards the students, really with no prodding from us, started talking about how it was if they had walked through the novel, and a lot of things that had seemed distant or not quite nonsensical, but things that didn't quite make sense to the students suddenly clicked into place and made sense when they were walking through this place, speaking in French, speaking with the guide, seeing evidence of the life that these peoples had lived, which connected completely with what they had read in the novel. And of course, the work that we did in preparation for the Oral Histories website, where the students studied Louisiana French, that gave them the background they needed to deal with the linguistic elements, as well as the elements of social and linguistic identity they ran into when they were doing the interviews with the Louisiana French speakers. We also, something we had not anticipated at all, was in connection with the broader understanding of the French populations of the U.S. and the American South, so something we had not anticipated, or at least I certainly had not, I don't think you had, is that many of our students came from the north of the United States. And during our final reflection section, we would have reflection sessions every evening with the students to talk about what they had experienced and how it connected to what they had, what we had done in class. And one of the students said that he always had just assumed the South was one homogenous entity and that people down there weren't very smart and weren't very well informed. And I have to say, as a Southerner, I was delighted when these students said, you know, that's not the case. And so that was kind of a bonus outcome that we hadn't even thought about, but we were very happy about. And then in direct connection with the service learning component and then the work we did with the Oral Histories website, the students talked about a great sense of satisfaction in that they had taken this, they had all been studying the French language, and then we had then specifically been studying Louisiana French and the history of Francophone Louisiana, and they were able then to go down and actually play a role not only in the more conventional service learning we did in New Orleans, which was working with a volunteer organization that deals with recycling and energy efficiency, but also going and working with these French speakers, letting these French speakers know that their language was valued, and then through the Oral History website, working to promote this language, create awareness for it, and that was something that the students talked about with a great deal of satisfaction. And then finally, and I don't know if I should say practically or selfishly, but you know, I imagine for all of you as well, in our language department, we're very concerned with numbers of majors and numbers with enrollment and all these kinds of things. And we started the class with one major, and by the end of it, we had half the class had enrolled as majors or minors. One of them has gone on to NYU Paris and is coming back to do the MABA program in French Studies. So kind of on a very selfish note, it ended up being a great way, you know, using this kind of service learning and the collaboration on this website was a great way to get students motivated in the subject. Yes. And then finally, and this is the greater student, that's actually, I should have hit this before I said that, but that's in connection to these students. It kind of brought them into our department, got them more excited about it, got them taking more classes. Once again, that's kind of the selfish outcome for us in the French department. But now Melanie is going to show us a bit about the Oral Histories website. Really fast.
So the Oral Histories website that we're building, it's still in a work in progress. It's hosted by NYU Department of French, and we hope to collaborate with the Linguistics Department. It's all student and faculty authored, and it's our goal for it is to be an oral history resource for North American French eventually. We'd kind of conceived of this Louisiana trip being alternating with a Quebec trip. So two credit courses that would kind of introduce students to French in North America, and to be used as a pedagogical resource and training tool eventually. So I'll just show you very briefly the site. So this is what it looks like. Basically, we have a short about the project. All of our students conducted interviews while they were in Louisiana with French speakers, and then as their final project, they had to transcribe and translate those and create a little lexicon of like Louisiana French words, words that were particular to that, which was a challenge for them because it's there's things that would be considered mistakes in standard French that aren't in Louisiana French. So we have all of those interviews as well as audio files for them, and we have our student transcriptions. And what we're hoping to do is have a student worker transcribe and translate the entire thing. And then eventually there'll be a pedagogical aspect of it where users can go and try and transcribe and translate their own portion and then compare that. There's also gonna be a small like Cajun dictionary words to avoid.
And we're hoping it's a chance for us to facilitate some cross-departmental work because we're talking with the Department of Linguistics to bring in students with French proficiency to help with transcription and be involved with that.
And it's great for our students because each of them does become a contributing author, so they're very proud. They all have put their photo up and some with a bio, links to their CV, and so, we've been really happy with it overall, so. Anything you wanted to add?
I think that's it.
Okay.
Okay, so moving along, we have Aileen and Sophie. Aileen and Zoe. So sorry about that. And let me pull up this one.
Yeah.
Okay, great.
Yeah, thank you. Okay, this is one of my students, Zoe Hall. And she's here to talk about what we are doing in this class. This is when we cannot travel, like John and Melanie, you have to pretend that you... I'm sorry, can you hear me? When you cannot travel, you have to pretend you travel. So we are... This is seven sections of French who are pretending that they live in a francophone country. So to start with, they have the first week of the class. All students in each class, they vote. They pick up a francophone country, and then they pick up a francophone city, and then they have to pick up a neighborhood, and then they have to pick up a building, a specific building. And then for like 3 months, they have to... the title is A Course in Which Students Are the Heroes. It's not the heroes and the, like today in the newspaper, like absolutely everybody becomes a hero in this world. Here, this is like in the old-fashioned way. They have to create a character that they put in this building, and they have to develop the personality, the future, and the past of their character. So this is, all students become a hero in the sense that they have to invent a fictional character and who is living in this building. So, okay, I have to put my glasses because, yeah. So, oops. Okay. Now, how do you go back? Yeah, okay, thank you. So basically, this is a vote process. This is what I was just saying before. They live together in a building that defines the social learning contract of the group, shapes its identity and its learning objective. And of course, every section is picking up another city and another country. So to start with, it's a new place. Of course, when students enter in a classroom, there is a social learning contract. They know they are here to study, to practice a language, but the idea is to make it explicit. Here in the classroom, there is an implicit contract that they are going to study and to speak another language. Here, we transpose everything in a building, and here they have to define and they really have to agree of what they are going to construct in this building between them and how they are going to engage which is other. So a new space. So this is a Google space. So every instructor has his or her own Google site. And so the students share an online space connecting their different places, the apartment, personal page of the students, which are visible, everybody can see them, the students read each other, the communal place of the building, there is a couple of activities that of course they do together when they explore the neighborhood or the city or the country. And So they develop their skills by experimenting the world through the eyes of their fictional character. So this is the first page of the site. Here you have, on the left, you have all the name of the students. So you click on their page and you enter into the apartment. And the Google site has different functions. It tracks, it registers and tracks the activity of the group. It houses students' personal open pages. Students not only write on their page, but also post their essay about their character, about their fictional character. And it displays the learning content. It also assures the development of the course and its continuity. And here I'm going to ask Zoe to talk briefly about the character. This is the first year that I have a student who is actually developing a character who is already a fictional character. And I find it really great, and I ask her to come here to talk about what she did, what she's doing.
Hello. Okay, so yeah, whenever I found out that I had to come up with my own character, at first I was just going to be one of my friends, like pretend that I was one of them the whole semester. But then I thought it would be really like hilarious to be Holden Caulfield every day that I come to French. So, you know, it's really fun to, like, imagine what Holden Caulfield would be doing if he was in Monte Carlo with a bunch of other French people who, you know, we have to talk to each other about who we are, what our likes and our dislikes are. We have a lot of, like, right now we're doing something about history or our ancestors, and it's really, like, really funny to come up with who Holden Caulfield's ancestors are. You know, like, it makes it a lot more fun to write whenever I'm being this person instead of just, like, doing an exercise where we come up with a story. It's really cohesive, and it also helps me get to know the other students more because I have to read about what they've said, and we have to collaborate together as our characters. And it is also just really funny to express myself, like, in this way. So, like, whenever we need, like, someone to be a Debbie Downer or something, it's me. And I don't have to feel like that's myself. I feel like it's Holden. So, I don't know. It's really cool. Okay.
Thank you very much. Okay, don't forget me, don't forget us. I'm a part of the game, of the role play. I'm not just an instructor, I have a character. So this is me, Varsovie, and I have my page, just like everybody else. I live in the building, and I'm writing the essay. I'm doing everything just like the students do. So it's an example for them, because of course each assignment is precise. They have to develop this and this and this, and I'm writing my assignment just like them, and they can go to my page to see what I'm doing. We do, in the beginning of the semester, we do a collaborative mapping. So here we are using a Google mapping. This is a mailbox. It's very artisanal, but it works. So students have to talk to each other, informal message, but everything is corrected. I send the correction because we don't want a Google site full of mistakes. So that's a lot of work for the instructor, but we correct everything, we send back, and students are supposed to correct and post it again. So you see it's green, so everything is fine. When it's blue, it means I had to go after, but that's okay. I think everybody accepts this, and they have no problem. And plus, you see the mistakes. You remind it. You see the mistake you are doing. This is a page where students have access to material online, the radio, the TV, and of course we customize this page according to where we live. It could be in France, it could be in Senegal, it could be anywhere, it could be Switzerland. So we change the link and we orient students toward a local newspaper and radio. This is other collaborative work, Vie de l'immeuble, everything that happened in the building between the tenants of the building. And there is also alert, so this is what's happening inside the city, but also inside the country. So students have to research. So basically, what I really like is that students themselves are responsible to develop, to create, and to develop the content of the course. So the content is not completely connected only to the curriculum, but it has an organic development. And you get what you get, you know? So this is a responsibility of everybody to make it work and to make it interesting. So we are using VoiceThread too. So I guess you all know VoiceThread. So this is our one movie. So everybody is posting comments. We have one semester, we organize a party with all the sections of French. So Zoe is in my class in Monte Carlo, but I had also a class in Cannes, and we had a class in Lyon, and two in Paris. So we all meet and we talk, and we do that once a semester. And then to accompany the course, we have a class pack. We made a course which is completely connected to the content, but we also developed grammar capsule, there is six of them, with articulate storyline, which is a fantastic program. And basically, this is for the concordance des temps, when students have to master the use of the past. So we go back to the past, and as Zoe told you, students have to find an ancestor to their character. And in this case, the ancestor may be connected to the French Revolution. So here, this is an example of what you can do with articulate storyline. And it's good because people...
Marie-Antoinette Autriche, Reine de France, vous souhaite la bienvenue dans ce module.
Mission impossible. Voyager dans le temps pour me sauver de la guillotine.
So she has a German accent. You can do that. You can make a voci and you write in French and you say, speak in German, and they got the German accent. So basically, here the students, they have to travel into the time to save the queen. And articulated storyline is really great You can do a lot of stuff. You can do interactive exercise. You can show, you can explain. You can have little quizzes. You can do all kind of things. So this is just an example of this wonderful software. And then finally, that's my last slide. So finally, the idea is that students will connect this semester to a place. I see this is the beauty of mnemonic. That's, you know, this old fashioned to learn through places. So as a metaphor, I like the idea of using a building in order not only to archive the experience, but also for each student somewhere. Zoe invited this character. I mean, she's making this character alive in Monte Carlo. She will, I mean, I think she will remember, and I will remember my character too. So somewhere it's a way to, it's a kind of image for associating what you have been learning through a place. And actually that's why I created this last capsule, French grammar capsule, which is, and there were six of them. This is a grammar with mnemonic, and I did that with Paris because I had, you know. But basically, we are associating a couple of grammar rules through places. And this is just, I was just experimenting. I'm not sure it works very well. We don't really have time to work with this. But it's more like an image of what I like to do with this course, what I wanted to do with this course, to associate an experience to a place. And that hoping that not only it's going to be, of course, collaborative writing and speaking and building, but also that somewhere it's going to stay in the memory of the participants. So I think that's it. You want to add something?
It is like a ton of fun, you know, to have like everything be so connected to each other. You know, like every week I know, oh, we're gonna be doing this in Monte Carlo, we're gonna be doing that. So I think it's been really helpful.
So we have one more panelist for our student-centered and active learning. We have Chen Gao from East Asian Studies to talk about the flipped classroom model in the Chinese language classroom.
So all our Chinese teachers will tell our students in the first day class that Chinese is easy to learn. But in the reality, we all know that's not true. The Defense Language Institute classifies Chinese as one of the Category 4 languages, which is exceptionally difficult for English speakers and requires longer hours to achieve the same proficiency standards as those of other languages. And we as educators here, we want to reach out to all the students, not only the smart ones. So because of that, class time is precious and we have to use it wisely. That's why I became very interested in the flipped classroom model. And although little is known about its efficacy in Chinese as foreign language classroom, I hope that it's a possible solution for us to use the class time most efficiently. So what is the flipped classroom? In the flipped classroom, we deliver new knowledge prior and outside of the classroom through interactive videos to prepare the student in a guided setting and free up valuable class time to enhance students' engagement and learning. But how can we apply this approach in Chinese classroom? And how can we achieve all these goals by using flipped classroom? So this spring, I wanted to find out. So I was teaching two sessions of intermediate one Chinese course. In one session, I used a traditional method. In the other, I used a flipped classroom so I could compare the learning outcomes. I also did interviews, surveys, and videotaped my own teaching to collect data. But Chinese is a tonal language, and it has a unique writing system. So I don't want my students to learn everything on their own and come to my class with their tones are all off and they cannot use the grammar correctly. So I did my research in a more conservative way. It was a three-round action research. I identified the problem in my classroom and then evaluate the results, come up with a plan and evaluate the result of each stage of the research and then change my plan. So in the flipped classroom, in the first round, I only moved the vocabulary teaching outside of the classroom. In the second round, I moved the vocabulary and the content outside of the classroom. In the third round, I moved the vocabulary, content, and even grammar outside of the classroom. One lesson I learned in the course of my research is that in the flipped classroom, you'd better make your own video and come up with original content. Because if the content in the video is too similar to the textbook or it's too similar to your lecture, students will have the tendency to ignore it and don't think it's necessary. So for each lesson, I wrote my own short essay, which is relevant to the textbook, but it's different, and I will test my students on it. I created a PowerPoint presentation of the vocabulary and text and converted them into videos, overlaying audio of my own speech. So I used what I learned from the workshop. I created videos using the screen capture software and upload the videos to NYU Stream and share with my students. Following the video, I created a list of low bar questions. So students can use the videos to study new vocabulary and then watch the instructional video. Also, they can show their understanding by answering those low bar questions. And I would provide instant feedback, and that's all be done before the class. In the classroom, we can see, because in the flipped classroom, teacher can predict what is difficult for the students, and students know about their own learning better. So we can actually use more time in the class focusing on question and answer, problem solving, and applying the skills, and we can do more discussion activities to support knowledge retention, which I cannot really do that in traditional classroom because we don't have enough time. Like I said, one thing I've learned is that you have to make the video different from the textbook. It should be more challenging and interesting. So for example, if the textbook is talking about the room layout and the furniture, in my video, I introduced NYU dorms and incorporating the new vocabulary. By doing that, I make it more related to students' daily life and make it more interesting. I also embedded culture elements by introducing students' dorms in China and the Chinese teachers' dorms in China. So, and also in the video, I don't give them subtitles. So they have to learn the vocabulary and know the pronunciation and meanings fully in order to understand the video. That subtitle, I only use subtitle when I introduce new word. So it's very rare. So when the textbook is talking about shopping, I made videos about how to shop in New York. So students from the surveys and the interviews, they say they really like this approach because they know they like the fact that they have more resources online. They know they have to go there. They can always go there and check. Also, to my surprise, I didn't ask them to take notes while they were listening to the video, but students told me they would watch these videos over and over and take notes, and also they learn the structures in the video, so they when they write their own essays, they use those structures. In the third round, I even took it to another level. I invited native speakers in my video to do interviews so my students can hear real Chinese speakers talking. I also did grammar mini lessons for the key structures. Usually in the class, I don't have time to give each student one example of the structure. But in the video, I can explain more and give them more examples. Also, I can talk about their possible mistakes. So in my classroom, it proves that the flipped classroom has helped them increase their learning outcomes. And the final product was a video made by my students. Basically, it's a combination of all the topics we've learned in the semester. Here is an example. So the interviews and introduce university. Okay. So the survey shows that most of the students, they have positive attitudes towards this approach. Of course, some of them complain about the extra work, but most of them, they think it's interesting and they can watch the videos at their own pace and watch the videos as many times as they want. And also they can watch the videos in a non-threatening environment, so maximize their confidence. So they, when they come to the class, they're more eager to participate in this classroom discussion. So after the research, I've discovered that the flipped classroom is a very good way to increase teacher contact time. And also it helps create an environment that increases students' responsibility of their own learning. But the flipped classroom is not just online videos. It's not just use technology for the technology's sake. It's not about replacing teachers with videos. As a Chinese teacher, I always feel that teaching language is like dancing in the chains. So there's a lot of things you have to consider about. There's a lot of decision making you have involved. So by doing this, for me, I feel like it's self-directed professional development to maximize the teacher agency. Thank you.